Good morning to everybody. This is the pitching session for the course number two of the Green Living Areas Learning Program. So we are very glad to welcome you today. My name is Cynthia Chavez. I'm from EMEA, and I have been the educational director in this edition. So I'm very glad to welcome you all. Together with the rest of my colleagues from the renewable energy communities, urban transport community, efficient buildings and green growth, we are happy to welcome you today. As you will know, this is the final, the pitching session for the course number two. So we will have the opportunity to hear the experience and the application of the challenge by one of the students. So let me please give the floor to my colleague, Laia Viñez. She's from MedCities, and she will explain us the agenda of the session. Thank you and enjoy.
Hi, good morning, everybody. So I am Laia Viñez, an officer at MedCities, project officer at MedCities. We are leading the urban transports community, and together with our colleagues of the efficient building and renewable energy communities, we have been working on this Med Green Living Areas group of different interesting courses. So about the cycling to decarbonize urban mobility challenge, today the idea is that we will recall a bit the objectives and the content of the of this course, what happened. We will give the floor to those that have taken the time and have completed the assignment. We have for at least that we know, as Cynthia was saying, one student that on top of not only she has fulfilled this assignment, but she will present two assignments, two challenges regarding the territories course as well. So we will have this presentation. We will then open the floor for anybody else wanting or wishing to present, to share how far they have gone in the course. Even if you haven't finalized the challenge, we invite you to take the floor and tell us a bit how this course and the whole program helped you reflect around sustainability in the Mediterranean. We will have our expert on cycling policies, Esther and Anaya, giving a bit of feedback to the different presentations. And we will for sure be closing by 11:30, if not a bit earlier. So just to recall, here we were talking about the city, we were at the city scale, and the objectives of the course were threefold. Firstly, to discuss and learn about the impacts of cycling measures in our cities in terms of welfare, equity, and sustainability. How does cycling affect the sustainability of our city? Learn how to analyze different scales of environment where we live, be it the street level, the neighborhood, or even the city. We, through the different videos and lessons, we introduce different indicators to understand what is the cycling environment around us. And finally, provide skills on planning and evaluating integrated cycling policies, which is the sort of the theoretical framework that our expert mostly works. So basically, this is the structure we had. We had six videos, e-lessons that you can still access, by the way, until the end of the month, if you're still interested. We distributed different self-assessment tests during the videos that we hope have been interesting for you. There was the assignment or the challenge that we asked you to respond to, and that we will hear today, the presentation. And We also run a number of tutorship sessions where you could get online with our expert and have a direct contact and feedback from her and solve doubts where I think it was useful for the people who use them. And also to remind that we extended the course that was initially foreseen for 1 week, we extended it to 2 weeks. So to make sure that anybody interested had enough time to complete. Well, I won't go through the details, but that's the content you can still find in module one. That's the team who was behind you, and I'm now going to give the floor to our cycling policies expert, Esther Anaya, to very briefly present the assignment, the challenge, what we were asking to you to complete, and how we expected you to do it. Esther, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Laia. And as Laia was saying, in this course, we've traveled together through the different dimensions of the integrated cycling policies. And the idea is that we are not only looking at infrastructure or the built environment, but we're also looking at actually planning instruments, regulations, training and coachings, governance, communications, and social and cultural movements and context. So once we've learned about all these dimensions, we know we can put them all together in a document that is going to be a master plan or a sustainable urban mobility plan, in which we're going to look at each of them and have like a roadmap for an action plan for all of them. So especially the second part of the course, the three last lessons, they were focusing on preparing yourself for the challenge. And then there was this assignment to getting to the practical side of it and analyze two of the dimensions that you think they were important in your context, in your case, and then produce also some action planning for both of them. So basically, we were asking you to use some slides with a brief introduction to the context, and then two slides, one for each dimension, introducing the dimension, providing a bit of data, a bit of information about that dimension that you've chosen. And then the last two slides would be just looking at what kind of actions could be done and how to measure the impact of these actions for each of the two dimensions that you have chosen. So hopefully this was structured and clear enough for you and not very difficult as a challenge. You could obviously take it to the level of depth that you wanted. Like you could just introduce it briefly, or if this was already part of your work, you could go more in depth. And we've definitely had some very interesting conversations over the tutorial sessions on how to take this to the practical level. So this was really the objective of the assignment. Once we know all the theory, how do we apply it? How does it come into practice? So hopefully that has been a good exercise for you. And if you haven't done it yet, then I would encourage you to do it. And if this session can be of help with these examples that we're gonna go through and the work of, specifically for Leila, who has been working on it, hopefully can be inspiring to you and you can delve into the assignment and make it come to life for your own case study, for your own context. So yeah, I think that was on my side what I wanted to go with you as an introductory and reminder of what we're doing with the challenge.
Thank you, Esther. I think we can now go directly to one of our best students, I can say. Leila Youssef, if you want to, if you need to share your screen, you can now do it. And yes, let's go directly to hear what you have prepared, which I recall, it's interesting because it puts together two of the courses of the Green Living Areas program. and responding to two of the challenges that we propose. So that makes it, I think, even more interesting to listen to it. And after your presentation, Leila, I will ask Esther to provide some feedback, and maybe the colleagues from other communities can also share their thoughts as well. Thank you, Leila.
Thank you and good morning. And I would like to thank Esther for the very interesting course. I hope I have do my best to elaborate challenge one and two. And if there I need to elaborate them, I'm ready to learn from her what she can give me as more idea. So I will start firstly to introduce I will firstly start to introduce myself. So I'm Leila Youssef, Assistant Director of International Project and the Program Unit at Greater Urban Municipality. I hold a master's degree in urban planning. So I'm urban planner, GIS analyst. I'm very interested to the subject of master plan, urban mobility, and GIS. So firstly, Erbid City, the second largest city in Jordan, is approximately 80 kilometers north of Amman, and it's composed by 23 districts. The municipality is committed to reduce carbon emission at 40%, and this based on the Sustainable Energy Climate Action Plan and our engagement with the convent of the mayor. Some action in this document are related to the mobility transportation. Now, it's very important, firstly, to understand what are the opportunities and challenges for our city. So we are 1 million citizen, which means we are metropolitan area. We have also in our area 200,000 Syrian refugees, and our area is 360 square kilometer. Regulatory land is 135 square kilometer. As a municipality in general, we deliver services for the community. Between them, the issue related to the mobility, and we have a very important urban development project. We take in consideration our urban city strategic plan based in sustainable development goal and new urban agenda. And based in those opportunity, our challenges are the health, environment, ecological, social, equity and accessibility, governance, economic, infrastructure, urban planning, and technology and innovation. So Erbid City, the city of Erbid contains several sectors: educational, commercial, health, and industrial, like Yarmouk University, which is in the middle center of the downtown, like Jordan University of Science and Technology. Health sector, we have Edo Military Hospital, Princess Rahma Hospital, and Erbid Specialized Hospital. We have also one of our important projects, Central Vegetable and Food Market a project. Those sector provide services not just at the level of Erbid City, but also at the level of the governorate. So Erbid City, as center of governorate, witnessed a series of daily trips to arrive to those services from citizens living inside and outside the city. During those daily trips, multiple means of transport are used, like buses, private yellow taxi, white taxi, coastal minibus, and a private cars, and there is a strong use of private cars. In fact, the daily movement of citizens with the multiple means of transport increased traffic congestion as well as fuel consumption and CO2 emission. Now, in our city, we have almost 8 bus terminal stops. And stops distributed in the different area of the city. One of them is the Urban Central Terminal, Erbid Central Terminal Bus, is working at high level at the government level. It's a terminal for different citizens coming from different municipalities that surrounded our city. The new upgrade have been done for this Erbit Satran terminal bus. Also, we have our transportation plan, and this plan have been elaborated during the elaboration of master plan for Erbit City. Now, Erbit mobility context in Erbit City, Erbit City is related to the increase in traffic congestion, fuel consumption, CO2 emission, and traffic accident. One of our projects to solve the issue of those different issues, it was the design and planning of low carbon mobility scenario through public consultation in Erbit City. The project have been elaborated in one of the area of the downtown. It's a periphery area called the Nusha district, and our corridor go through different neighborhoods. The axis is almost four kilometers. The axis is surrounded by very important urban activity. We have Yarmouk University, educative Yarmouk University. We have administrative building, government camp, and we have different variety of more commercial activity related to the corridors and the Azmol also. We have the Erbit terminal bus and the different variety of typology of building between apartment and villa. And we have different restaurant in this area, and we have a very important sport city in this area also. So there is different pictures show the building in this area. And one of the output that we have elaborate for this project proposal, we have three. One of them is the proposed cycle path from the terminal bus to the university. The proposal is this is a great opportunity that we have this course, which will help us to elaborate more details and reflection about this this project, and more specifically about the proposition to have cycle paths to connect two points in the area or our project. The question is how to achieve, besides cycling, I consider walking very important also. So cycling transformation, how to achieve cycling transformation in Erbit City, and a vision how Erbit City becomes city of cyclists, because our city is flat city. So this is a very important issue that can we have success in the proposition of cycling strategic plan. Now, concerning the first evaluation of cycling policies presenting first challenge, I take in consideration the cycling policy elaborated by Esther, and then I have take 2 points between them, the question of infrastructure and the cycling lines and the communication. So, you know, we have not in our city cycling plan. This is why we start to propose this, and we have not existing indicator, but we will propose different indicator based in the course, based in what I have do as reading. So the first different indicator are elaborate to cycling infrastructures and cycling line, more specifically the question of to have safe cycling line as indicator, maintain safe motors vehicle speed, considering installing a low speed zone, maintaining coherent network. The question of directness connection should allow cyclists to take the short possible route to their destination. Another indicator, coherence across the network, the design and implementation of the world bike network should reflect a consistent visual identity and design standard ensure a safe design, line dimension and placement, key consideration for selecting bike line width, line separation and degree of separation. This will be elaborated through GIS analysis, more specifically GIS network analysis. Okay, another indicator which I have found in relation to the different reading that I have do is the question of line. It's in addition to what I have said, line width, line placement, line entry and exit, which is very important, control, bidirectional line. This part is very important. Also, selecting appropriate bike infrastructure according to vehicle speed, like shared bicycle street, bike line speed, protect bike line also, which is very important. Road bike track, also related to the question of speed. Those can give us different indicator to the subject of infrastructure and cycle line. A question of visibility, of turning, of protection and signal also, which is very important. So in addition to this point, as I have said, infrastructure cycling, and I give some point to take in consideration as indicator and analysis and description, the communication, which is the second point of the policy strategy for cycling. I consider it's very important. It need to elaborate communication and visibility plan where we have different, we can have a local committee project more specific for this project. And we have to elaborate a mapping stakeholder to engage correctly the needed different stakeholder to this project. And each local committee project will be conducted through different meeting related to the duration of the project, and each meeting we can elaborate a report that indicate the opinion or based in the questionnaire the needs of the stakeholders in relation to this subject. So as the strategic cycling planning, we have Urban Center Terminal Bus, and we have the Yarmouk University. The question is how we can have a safe bicycle cycle line. And what we propose is to do firstly based in the indicator GIS analysis to understand the hierarchy of the street, to understand all the elements which we can elaborate from the indicator and put them on map and try based in this maybe we can propose different scenario, and based in this we can put some criteria to choose the best line. Also based in GIS analyst. Concerning the parking, the municipality have to play a role in this, and we can propose land owned by the municipality as parking to the bicycle to the bicycle used. Okay, so concerning the communication, awareness committee will be established, composed by Greater Municipality, Yarmouk University, Ministry of Transport, Civil Organization, Land Transport Authority, and local community. All those parts can be pertinent to this project, and be involved through the different meeting of stakeholder in this project. Okay. So now I will go to this strategic cycling planning, the second challenge. I will elaborate 2 points, stakeholder engagement and the data. We consider that in general, the project is under the idea to reduce carbon emission in the transport sector and general vision for our city. The data, it's very important. And we have based in, I consider data based in GIS analysis and building geodata for transportation. The cycling can be part of this geodatabase is very important for the best decision concerning the elaboration of the master mobility plan, which can contain the cycling issue. And the stakeholder is very important. With my experience with a different project that elaborate in the city, the question to engage a stakeholder is very important from the first time that citizen, that local community, that municipality and other partner can be aware about what we will do, the goal and how we will achieve this. So all this success process, progress in the process will help us to elaborate strategic cycle planning and sustainable efficiency mobility. Now, when I talk about stakeholder engagement, as also experienced through our project, stakeholder engagement was a very key element to engage the different partner. For this, we have elaborated different meetings that have been elaborated. And I give here a different example for stakeholder, how we elaborate it. Different meeting at the level of municipality group working this subject, and we have different discussion and different meeting about the evolution of the concept of low carbon mobility and between them the scenario of bicycle. We have established also traffic awareness and association team composed by students of the university. Like this, we be sure that they will be involved with us from the first time. And we have different meeting to talk about the project and we have how is the vision about the question of mobility, what can be the challenge of the mobility. And we, if we propose the pedestrian line, cycle line, how the society can for bicycle line accept this, or so we have different discussion about different project about different point concerning the project. We have with Yarmouk University also different meeting to talk about this area and how the university can play a very important role to elaborate the question, more specifically the question of a bicycle, because we are city that they that the city does not use the bicycle. So the first step is to know exactly where we can be sure that the project can be success and how it's important to start with the student. We have here very important university in our city and also at the regional level, Yarmouk University, and not so far from the urban terminal bus, urban terminal bus. So how we can based in this propose something related to bicycle line and elaborate this issue. So we have different public consultation based in our part with our partner. And the idea was to group them under different within the different table. Each table will have one responsible. The question is also to give a training for the responsible for each table to know exactly how to inform and involve the different stakeholders and how to record the report based in our the information or the idea of the different stakeholder in each table, how to record it and take a note of this. This is very important because at the end of each meeting, we will have a final report that contain the information, the idea of the stakeholder. So the idea is to elaborate more the question of the scenario of stakeholder engagement, where we each table we can have five questions. We can elaborate them based in a general idea about the city and go more specifically about the question of bicycle. And this way is the progress in the way how we can keep the stakeholders engaged and give them information and to get from them also. So the final idea is when we engage a stakeholder, we have to elaborate a methodology to the participatory process and take in consideration that it's the engagement of stakeholder is a big question because the output of the stakeholder is important for the project. The question is not just to put a line in the street for bicycle, but also we need the good engagement of stakeholders. And I believe this is like you are doing the marketing for your project. You have to know how to deal with the stakeholders. So if I want to resume, we have city challenges, we have the corridors, and we have to propose the strategic cycle planning. And like this, I think, and I have finished my idea about the two challenges. I have, I hope, and I have do my best. And thank you very much. If you have any question, thank you.
Thank you, Leila. I hope you can hear me well. I was
not very well, Leila.
Okay, Esther, if you want to give feedback to Leila directly, while I solve my problems.
Yes, thank you. First of all, congratulations, Leila. You've done wonderful work. And I can see many of the ideas of the course already reflected in this work and applied to the practical terms, and that there is thinking behind it. And also, I appreciate that you have obviously taken it to your context. And that makes it more realistic, and also more prone to be successful. And I have taken a few notes that maybe will also, apart from give you feedback, will also help other people participating in the course to also produce their own exercise, produce their own challenge. So first of all, looking at your context, I think actually Euro-MED is the perfect size for a cycling city because it's not too big in terms of population. It's not too populated either. So it's like a medium-sized city, we could call. And especially when you talk about these axes that you want to look at, the connection between the university and the bus hub, this distance is about 2 kilometers, if I got it well. So this is more or less between 10-15 minutes by bike. This is perfect for people who are not used to cycling heavily every day. So this is perfect for people that need to be introduced to cycling, which is sometimes the case of university students. So usually we're dealing with this group of population, the student, the young people, who maybe they used a bicycle when they were children, but it's very common that they stop during the teenage. So many of these children just stop during the teenage just because it's not cool, or they change the school to high school, and there's a lot of social pressure as well, and that there is a gap in between those ages. And this is a very important gap for cycle planning, because if we manage to get people back to cycling when they're young, after this impasse of the teenage, that is very helpful for them then to provide situations so that they can continue cycling. So what you are producing here, it will affect a population that might help them think about cycling for the rest of their lives. So you're helping them getting back to cycling, and making this possible or making this a possibility for them for the rest of their life. So this is a very important group of people that you're tackling with this project. This also means that, as you have already taken into account, which is very good, is that you need to make this infrastructure as safe as possible, not only in real safety, but also perceived safety. So that means the perception of safety is very influenced by the separation of the cycling lanes, so how protected they are from traffic. So I think this is a very good opportunity to look at these streets. And, you know, it depends on the type of street, but what you want to do is to protect cyclists as much as possible in this specific connection, because you know the population that you're going to be targeting is this young people population that you want to bring back to cycling and then make them think that cycling is safe and that they can do it. So one idea would be to really, as you were very well already showing, add the information layer of the intensity of traffic, speed of traffic in every little section of this axis, or also going there, doing some observation, how is traffic in every bit. And in the end, cycle planning in terms of infrastructure can be very detailed, can go to very micro level. So really go street by street level and seeing how things are, what are your resources in terms of space, and what are the conditions in terms of speed and flow, intensity of traffic in each of the areas, behavior of the drivers as well, signalization, whether there are traffic lights or not, and things like that are going to be very important to really make these access as safe as possible for cycling and to design the best possible infrastructure for this access. So that's one thing. I also appreciated that you mentioned walking is very important. So when you do this review for this axis, make sure it's not only safe for walking, not only safe for cycling, but also for walking. So what we don't want is that, because if we want this cycling safety, we are making walking less comfortable, for example, by taking the space of the pedestrians and taking the space from the motorized traffic instead. So this cycle lane is either need to be taking space from the road or creating this, what we call the third level, a different level from the sidewalk and from the road, so that it is protected and it's not taking space from pedestrians, not generating conflict with pedestrians, because this is very important that people can actually walk if they want in the best possible way between these two important nodes of mobility in the city. Also to mention, this is a conversation we had in the tutorial, the concept of mobility nodes or these points of attraction of mobility. You have selected here two very important ones, but the city is populated with a lot of these nodes that you can identify as well. So we're looking into these axes and these two particular nodes, but I'm sure there will be other interactions with other attraction of mobility around these nodes. So maybe people would like to move from the bus hub to doing some shopping in some area, or to going to some sports center somewhere. Mapping that you were doing of all the services in the city, that's also going to be very helpful for you to know, okay, people want to move between these two nodes, but also people will want to do other trips in relation to this area. Maybe they have children, they need to take them to school before going to university, or pick them up from school after going to university. And you also want to make sure they are able to do it in the same trip. Sometimes you have different stages in the same trip. You have a main trip, which is this from the bus stop to the university, but that's not the only thing you're going to do during your day. You're probably going to do other trips, and you want to make that also into your planning strategy. I also realize now that I talk about children. Usually it's women who take care of these of the children who have these caring responsibilities. And I am very glad to see that in your pictures of engagement with the The student, the young people from the university, the meetings were basically almost all women. So that is a very important approach that you want to have. And this is also something that we've discussed in these videos in the course, that you want to bring all the different groups of population to the table, and you want to also have a diverse team of planners, in which having you, Leila, a woman, you already have this mentality and you can bring this mentality to your planning. So this is, I was just to highlight how important this is, that you bring these approaches to the table as well. I was also, this is something that you brought up that was very important, and that I'm sure other people might find when they do this challenge, is the problem with data. Yeah, we also discussed it in the tutorials, how sometimes you just don't have the data you would like to have to take the decision or to do the planning in the best possible way. So sometimes you have to produce this data, or to plan how to produce this data, maybe look for funding to put some bicycle counters or to do some observations with some teams on the street to really know what's going on with cycling in your city. And this is very important, even if you don't have it at your starting point, to plan how would it be to have it, what would you need to put in place to have this information, maybe in a year's time, in some months' time, or as part of your sustainable urban mobility planning, or of your planning in general. What would you need to know if you don't know yet? And what do you need to know and to put that measurements in place? So that's very important reflection that I see you've also gone through. And it's very common, like, don't feel like it's something that is special to your city. Like, it's very, very common that we start planning and we realize, oh, I don't have this data, so how can I take this decision? I don't know how many cyclists I have in this street already. So maybe you just need to go and count them, or some funding or some resources so that you know what is going on already about that. So this is very important to make it part of the planning, and it's part of the evaluation itself to this exercise that we were discussing in the videos, to know what are the indicators you want to have. And then if you don't have them, then plan how to have them. So yeah, that's one thing that I see this very, very important, and that you have taken it into account. You also talk about connection, and this is something that we've already discussed for this reflection on, there might be other places people want to do, they want to go. So the coherence, you talk about this coherent, and is actually part of this concept as well. We want the network, the cycle network, to be intra-connected and interconnected. Intra-connected in a way that you have a territory, your city, your neighborhood, whatever territory you're working with, and you want the network to be continuous. So you don't want to have gaps in the network, because that would mean a cyclist having to leave their bikes and start walking because they don't know where to go, or they don't know how to go through this junction that is, it looks very complicated, looks very busy with traffic, etc. You want to have this intra-connection, which means taking care of what we call the transitions. So you have different parts of your cycling infrastructure. They can be cycle lanes, but they can also be traffic calming areas, for example, 30 kilometer per hour lanes and things like that. But you want the cyclists to know at every time, where are they, what are the conditions, and how they can move forward with those conditions. So signalization is going to be very important. Like, even when you are doing works on the road, just make sure you are telling cyclists where to go, and that is accessible for them, that they don't need to dismount because there is a curb, or that there are some steps, or there are some blocks on the cycle lane. So this continuity in the inside of the network is very important, to make sure all the little bits, all the little pieces of the network are connected. Okay, and then the other one, the interconnection, is you have your area of study. In your case, is a very detailed one axis. And as I was saying, you also need to take into account what happens apart from that, what happens around that, beyond those networks. And if it's the whole city, it's the same thing, because if it's an urban continuum, it's very likely that you'll have this metropolitan effect in which you want to connect with the rest of the neighborhoods, the rest of the municipalities that are nearby. So also to bear in mind that when we do a cycle planning for a city, we are also looking at the connections between that city and the rest of the surrounding areas. So that is kind of a zoom that we need to do when we need to go, what would be the connection between the city and the rest of the territories that surround this city. And in your case, Leila, would be this reflection that we've already done. We have this axis and we're focusing on this, but at the same time, just a little bit of thinking what would happen when people want to go to other places from here. Yes. Is this ready for them, or this is probably the next step, but also start thinking about it, because sometimes some aspects of your design of this network will be conditioned by this other surrounding demand of mobility that you may have, for example, a school nearby that, you know, some students will want to take their children, or some shopping area that, you know, the students will want to go, sports area, parks, you know, something that also leisure is play a role of on people demand for cycling mobility. So always trying to put everything in a wider context will help you for the future to have things already in place if you want to take it from there, if that makes sense. And I think your GIS expertise is very, very useful and valuable for doing this analysis. So this is a very useful tool that you are already using that I think is going to be very helpful for you to be able to analyze all this information and put it in a visual way so that you then can plan based on all of that. So that's great. I would like to move on to stakeholder engagement. I'm not sure, Laia, how much time do I have left, but I do have some notes more that I would like to share. Yeah.
I mean, if you want to briefly close up with that, with those comments, I would like to know if in the room there's anybody else wanting to input. Thanks.
Okay. So yeah, and then I will focus on the stakeholder engagement that you describe. And I think that is a very good exercise that you've done, because in itself, when we talk about governance in general, sometimes this means we need to do a specific planning exercise on how would we like our governance to work. So this will mean we need to put in place what kind of channels of communication we're going to do, what type of, as you were saying, stakeholder mapping, which is also something that we've discussed in the videos. How do we locate or identify which are the groups, the entities, or the organizations that we want to bring to the table? So this is a very important aspect of the planning, the governance, and we might want to do a specific document, a little governance plan in itself in parallel to the cycling planning. I usually put them both together. So inside the cycle planning, there's this chapter of governance, is already one of the dimensions of the integrated cycling policy, but it goes absolutely in parallel with everything we do. So it's very good that you're already thinking about it, thinking in actual terms, how is it going to work? We're going to have some tables, we're going to have some people facilitating this discussion, etc. And I would also add, when we do that kind of having different tables and different questions, and as you were saying, it's very important that people take note and report, etc. This means you need to also train these facilitators. And so that's something that you might also put in your governance plan. Like, what do I need to tell the rapporteur in this table that they need to do? They need to bring in these questions. They need to take note. They need to moderate the discussion, all of that stuff. You might want to give them a little bit of training because people also will feel more confident doing what they're doing and being able to report to you, to come back to you with better information, better quality of the information that has been discussed in these tables, because this is really a very valuable tool. And also to add that this can be done online. Leila, it's perfect if you can do it in person, but if, you know, we're in a pandemic, if anything happens, sometimes it's also possible. And I have that experience as well, that you can actually do it online and collect all this information online. So feel free to you know, be flexible. This would be maybe my last point. I think it's also discussed somewhere in the videos, but allow for your planning, for your evaluation to be flexible and to then be able to take into account changes, disruptions, and contingency that might happen. Yeah. So I would leave it here for the time being. If there are any questions from the rest of the attendees, or we want to ask them to also provide a little bit of information about themselves, that would be lovely.
Yeah, thank you very much, Esther. That was a rich feedback. I was seeing Leila taking notes, so I'm sure she will use all that. I don't know if in the room there's anybody else wanting to have a word about Leila's presentation, Leila's case. Maybe Emilia. I don't know who you are, so maybe you can all start by introducing yourself and tell us a bit. Thanks.
My name is Emilia Rabito, and I work for the Euro-Mediterranean Center for Sustainable Development in Italy. I couldn't follow the first seminar about this topic, so sorry for that. but I saw the real interesting work that Leila did. We are doing a project about sustainable development, and also mobility. Sustainable mobility is one of our sector of interest. And what I would like to ask to Leila if is about the engagement of stakeholders, because who does this kind of project knows that is the real difficulty of because you can have a really nice project, but if you don't have the engagement of the stakeholders and of the actors that are part and are the beneficiaries also of the actions, it becomes very difficult to carry on the activities because it has to be accepted, because it's a real change in the mobility plan of the city. So my question is, what kind of approach methodology you think use? Because you spoke about methodologies of engagement, and if you have already thought to what kind of methodology, probably I missed this step, you think to use, if, for example, Esther suggested also online, of course, because in a big city it's very difficult to engage all the stakeholders, but probably the university is one of the sites that can be interesting to pose some questions, to pose some also to understand the needs of the students that are in the university campus, that I saw that is in the road, so probably they will be the main users, final users of these, or if you have also thought about a structured type of engagement, putting together, yes, there were also these working tables with different stakeholders, putting together public, private, citizens, and probably a research institution that can give you some advices on how to implement the process.
Merci. Thank you for your question. I would like to, if I have stopped sharing screen or not.
Yes, okay.
You know, the question of stakeholders, through my experience, is not the engagement of stakeholders is not something easy question, because it's in fact a challenge to bring people under those different category in the same table and to stay and to discuss is not easy, you know. How to keep them involved during all the progress of the work. And sometimes you do the best preparation for the meeting of the stakeholders. You prepare the agenda, you prepare a brief note about the project and all this, and you talk about people, that it's important that you be in this meeting. At the end, they are not in this meeting. So the question of the engagement is not of stakeholder, is not something easy, but there is a different methodology which I have learned. I can share with you the document if you are interested. You can just give me your emails. I will share with you the different document I have used to understand the methodology of that we have used through different projects. How we engage different stakeholders. I can share with you those documents, very interesting document. Okay, but just to write me your emails. And yeah. Yes.
Thank you. I will write in the chat.
Yeah, if I can add some comments as well, based on my experience and what we discussed in the course as well. There are some points I can also share. So usually this is a process of building trust, and sometimes it takes time. So we need to be conscious of that. We need to be conscious that it takes time, it takes resources. And I would also say that the final objective is to create a planning that makes people feel they belong. So it creates belonging, right? Yes. So that's our objective, is make people feel they will belong to the policies we are creating. To make them feel they belong, one of the aspects is to create a governance or a participatory process in which people will perceive there is space for them to provide their own information, their own feedback, so that they can be part of the decision making. That the decisions are not yet taking, that maybe the city council has done a lot of work and they have retrieved a lot of information, but there is an invitation to come into the decision making process, that the people that participate, they need to realize they have that opportunity, that the city council counts with them and it's allowing them to participate in the decision making process. And it needs to be made very clear from the beginning, like, what is this going? We want to decision, we want your points of view, we want your information, we want your feedback, because we're going to use it like this, in this specific way. So in this information note that Leila was saying, what I would be putting is all of this information, saying, what is this about? What are we allowing you to do here? And the objective is to create belonging, like express it in a different way, but these are the objectives that need to be in your mind when you design this.
Thank you, Esther. But and I think also we have to work at two levels. We have to work at the level of each category. We have to have close meeting with them before the general meeting. and to give them the opportunity to understand very well, to have a small meeting to discuss, to put a map, to draw. This is the best way to start. Yes, thank you.
Yes, definitely. That's why I was saying it's going to take time, it's going to take resources. And sometimes just doing the stakeholder mapping, it consists in what you just said, approaching each of them individually and explaining them and seeing what are their needs and what are their requests one by one, and then being able to bring them together. Yeah. Does that help, Amelia? I'm not sure if she can hear.
And I will add another aspect that it's also relevant about the data collection. No? I mean, Esther already mentioned about the GIS, so this is wonderful that because it's a very useful tool that then you can also see the evolution. But I think that one element that helps a lot to see the precisely this evolution and to understand the performance and the behavior of people, to try to do this data collection periodically. So I encourage you, if you have the occasion, to do surveys or, I mean, any, because as you said, we are all, we all know that the engagement process, it's very hard. So that people that follow and participate, it's very important to maintain them. So I think that if you manage to also incorporate like a kind of a monitoring system, not difficult, but you know, those basic data that you can follow properly. Because then with the decision makers, it's strong for you to say, hey, here how many, even for example, children or women that are using a bicycle, also the interaction with the economic activities that you have along these axes. Because then if you see, for example, if there is a building with offices, I don't know, so they also became part of the key actors in the planning of the cycling paths.
Yes, and I think the idea is the design, the concept of the design of the GIS data, geodatabase, is based in the collect, in the way how we collect the information concerning the different, can be category related to the planning, bicycle planning. So we have to understand that GIS is at the end. So we have to start firstly to collect the data in the field, do online survey, and there is a different step before the elaboration of the geodatabase of, yes.
And also, for example, one of the things that we were commenting at the starting of the learning program is that, for example, if you think about in a systemic approach, then later on you can link other plans or other initiatives that also help you to strengthen measures from the active mobility in this case, but also with, for example, efficient buildings. So
yes, yeah. It's under the general idea of the efficient, sustainable city. Yes, it's in this.
So I don't know, because we know that you follow as well the first course. So if you have any conclusion from yourself or reflection about that, also give you during the lessons or the material that you follow. Would be good to have also these short impressions from your side or from Emilia also, and Sakib. Sakib, if you want to also add any further comment, would be great. Leila, I don't know, because I think
I think in general, the idea is, as you see from our municipality, we have elaborated the SICAP document, which is the Sustainable Energy Climate Action Plan. And mobility is one issue for this. The efficiency of the building, the energy of energy efficiency of the building, it's a very important issue. So it is not a specific vision for mobility, but also a general vision for the city, how it can be more healthy city, more green city, more efficient city. For example, for us, we have started with a different project at the level of the municipality to convert them to green building. And it's a very interesting project with the European Union. And we are also integrating the sustainable development goals at the really at the indicator level to understand how we can have more efficient decision concerning the building at the level of the building, the neighborhood, and the city. If you are interested in this project, I can share with you. This is a very interesting project.
If I can, referring to this, to the buildings that of course can reduce the CO2 emissions. SVIMED was part of a project in the communities of the building. Okay, I don't remember the name of the community project, the horizontal project of the Interreg Med about the buildings. Renewable buildings, I think, and it was the Edu Footprint project where we tested a tool that calculates the whole life cycle of the building, because of course in a building there are a lot of input that is not only energy but activities that produce, of course, CO2 emissions. So if you want, I can share with you this project, if you want to give a look, that can be for a community, for a municipality that want to become greener. And the buildings are the one of the major producing and consumption of energy in different way that energy can be conceived, because when you consume products, of course, you also consume energy depending on the product you are doing. Different behaviors, our behaviors can influence, of course, the emission, CO2 emission of buildings. So I can share with you the link of the project, Leila, if you
yes.
can be interested.
Yes, sure.
So yeah, actually, Emilio is one. It's from Ireg. They are partners in the Fission Buildings.
Yes, thanks, Cynthia. I was going to interrupt. I think you're talking about the footprint project. That is an Excel calculator tool that allows you to calculate all the footprint of a school, and now the tool is adapted also to be used in other buildings typologies,
public buildings in general. Yes.
Okay. Is there anybody else wanting to have a word before we, I think we will close here, this pitching session? Leila?
Yes, I want just to thank Esther very much for the structure and of the course and the progress and the idea and the reflection about the planning, cycling planning. So thank you very much. I learned a lot of things, and I hope I will adapt them at the level of my work and the city. Thank you very much.
Thank you to you, Leila. We're very pleased that you follow and will make us very proud.
Yeah, thank you, Leila.
Thank you.
We stay in touch.
So, Laia, I think that we can finish the session, no? Okay, so thank you to all. And tomorrow, just a reminder, tomorrow we have also the pitching session of the course 3. So they are working on the territorial scale, the green living territories. And then after that, we will have the closure. So it's important that if you can join us, would be great. And later on, we will send you a survey of satisfaction. So we can, this was the first edition of this learning program. So we are very happy to know, we are expecting to know better how this impact to you and to improve ourselves, of course. So thank you, Esther, Laia, Emilio, Leila, Emilia, Sakib, and Alexia. And see you very soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Everyone.
Bye.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you. See you tomorrow.
Goodbye.